Thank you. So the topic of the talk is about how our bonding the number of rational points in sets definable in some au minimal or not au minimal structure. Okay, so this is a funny game because probably there is no rational point in the set we are going to look at. But it is so difficult to prove that there is no rational point or there is one or two or some rational points in a given set that the game is to produce bounds for the number of rational points. The main result in this direction is Pillar and Wilkie theorem. And to remind you this statement, I need some notation. So X is a definable set in some or minimal structure over the reals, and we are going to look for rational points in X. So a point X is in Rn, a point X written as X1, Xn with rational components is said a rational point. Okay. In fact, in general, it's very complicated to search for such points. So we are searching for rational points with some technical additional properties, namely rational points with bounded height. So what is the height of a rational point? So take X, a rational point in Rn. The height of X, denoted by H of X, is a maximum of the absolute values of of the numerators and the denominators of the components of X. In some irreducible representation of these components, okay, and we are going to look for rational points with 8 less than some integer t. So t is supposed to be bigger than 1. Okay, this is a technical thing. The good thing is that the number of rational points in Rn of 8 less than t is finite. So this is a point. Okay. So if we look for rational points of 8 less than t in X, then we have a finite number of points, and now we are interested in the asymptotics with respect to t of this bound. Okay. But what is known is that when X capital X is algebraic or semi-algebraic, the number of such rational points lying in X may be maximal in some sense. So we are not very interested in the semi-algebraic pieces lying in capital X. So we are going to look for rational points in the transcendental part of X. What is the transcendental part of X? This is a complement of the algebraic part of X in X. So what is the algebraic part of X? The algebraic part of X is by definition the set of points small x in capital X, so that there exists, let's say, a one-dimensional semi-algebraic set of Rn connected such that X is in A and A is inside X. Okay? So I don't consider all the semi-algebraic thing of dimension one, of pure dimension one, I can see in X. Okay? But of course, in general, this set is no more definable, at least in the same structure it may be definable in some structure, but in general, it is not. Okay, so the transcendental part of X is something very complicated for us. And now, all the notation are given to state Pila and Wilkie theorem. So with this notation, for epsilon, a real which is greater than zero, So there exists a constant depending on x and epsilon, such that for all t, the number of rational point in x of 8 less than t is less than c t to the epsilon. Okay. So in this situation, we are in some ominimal structure. Okay, and this is in, of course, in x trans. So here, the set of rational points of x of 8 of 8 less than t. Okay? It means that there are few points asymptotically of 8 less than t in the transcendental part of x as soon as x is in some minimal structure. So now the question is ominimality necessary for this kind of result? And how? And how far it is necessary? Okay. So we are going to investigate the case where the structure we are working with is no more an ominimal structure. Question. Can we get rid of ominimality? Okay, so from this point, this is a joint work. With Chris Miller. And a first way to weaken ominimality is to look at a structure which is not ominimal but which does not define Z. Okay? We can imagine a situation like this. On the left side, we have a structure defining Z. So in this case, the definable sets are horrible, and for sure we don't have bounds, we don't have reasonable bounds, we don't have Pillar-Wilkie's type bounds for definable sets in this horrible structure. On the right part of this line, we have S an ominimal structure. So in this case, we do have Pillar-Wilkie. This is a statement I just written here. And now we are looking at structures in this domain. So now S is not ominimal, but do not define the integers. So in this situation, everything may happen. For instance, if you look at the expansion of R by some cyclic group, okay, or if we look at the expansion of the ordered real field by algebraic numbers, so we have two situations. So in the first case, we know that definable sets are countable unions of semi-algebraic ones. So if we look at the transcendental part of sets of dimension greater than one, this transcendental part is empty. So for stupid reason, we have Pillai-Wilkie for sets of dimension bigger than one. And for a zero-dimensional set, we are not allowed to take away points in this process. We are not allowed to take away points, only one-dimensional semi-algebraic pieces, by a result of Hieronymi and Miller. We know that we have Pillai-Wilkie, okay, for zero-dimensional sets. So here, for subtle reason for zero-dimensional set, but for stupid reason for other dimension, we have Pillai-Wilkie. Okay. Of course, in this situation, we do not have Pillai-Wilkie because the set of algebraic numbers does not satisfy Pillai-Wilkie. So everything may happen in this situation. But here you see that Pillai-Wilkie is possible because of stupid reason, because of semi-algebraic facts. So now we are going to concentrate on a set definable in some a structure which is not a minimal. The structure does not define Z. And we are going to look for rational points in some transcendental set. So we want to avoid semi-algebraic sets in our structure. So maybe the best thing to do is to take F a transcendental definable function in a structure that does not define Z, okay? And look at the graph of F. Okay. And we are trying to find bounds for the number of rational points in this graph of 8 less than t. So this is a reasonable configuration to start with. And in the first part of my talk, I will sum up Pillai and Wilkie's proof in order to see to what extent it can be generalized to this situation. So very quickly, let me summarize the proof. Three steps in this proof. So the first one consists in proving generalization of Yamdin Gromov parametrization. Parametrization theorem in the minimal case. So the game is like this. You try to find a finite number x being definable. You try to find a finite number of shots defined on some box of the same dimension as x. Okay. Such that x is covered by the images of of the chart, yeah. Well, this is phi I is supposed to be CK, okay? Phi I is supposed to be CK. And last but not least, all the derivatives of phi I up to k are bounded by one. Okay. So this result has been obtained by Yamdin a long time ago. and it has been generalized by Pillai-Wilky, and this is at least half of the paper of Pillai-Wilky, okay? Okay. So we can't do that for in any minimal structure. Now the second step. The second step is a classical step that I will explain later if I have time, and if I don't have time, I will skip this, this step. Second step, for each chart, find a finite number of polynomials. Okay, this number is in terms of of t and d, d being the degree, the maximal degree allowed for these polynomials, such that such that the rational points not in X but in the range of the chart is in the union of the algebraic hypersurface given by these polynomials. Okay, so Okay. So this is a classical thing. And in their paper, Pillai and Wilkie use Bombieri-Pillai determinant trick to obtain these polynomials. Okay. So now the last step is easy in the minimal case. You have a certain number of such charts. For each chart, you have a certain number of hypersurfaces. Okay. Now, okay, I'm cheating a little bit, but now imagine that your algebraic hypersurface cuts your transcendental set, the transcendental part of X, in a finite number of points. Then if you can bound this number of points, then you are done, because everything is controlled at each step. Okay. So of course, in general, the intersection of these hypersurfaces with the transcendental part of X is not a point, but you can proceed by induction, and okay. So the idea is that is here. You can imagine that this guy cuts the transcendental part of the image of phi in the finite number of points, and since we are in some minimal structure, since the degree of p is bounded by d, then we have a uniform bound, whatever the coefficients of the polynomials are, and we are done. Okay. So now, in our very easy non-minimal situation, I remind you that I choose a transcendental function and I look for rational points in the graph of this function. We do not use Yamdin-Gromov statement, because we have a graph, and if we have a graph, we have a wonderful chart given by the graph. Okay? So we don't care about this part, about the first step. And now, let's see how we can generalize the second step. So, you can imagine, for instance, that f is fl, where fl is sine log l of x. Okay. So this is not a non-minimal function, of course. And in this family, there is a certain sensitivity with respect to the parameter L concerning the fact of defining Z or not. Okay. So if L is 1, then the expansion of the real field by F1 does not define Z, by a result of Chris, I think. It's a result of you, I think, Chris? Okay, Chris is sleeping, okay. No, by Chris and Patrick, okay. And if L is bigger than 1, then we have Z, okay? So, is there something special with this parameter concerning rational points in this situation? Question? We will see that the answer is no. Okay, so now I pick a point A on the real line, and I look at the graph over an interval of length L starting at A. Okay. Okay. I'm not sure I have time to explain things in detail, so I will be quick on this part. On this part of the graph, I use Bombieri-Pilat determinant trick. Okay. And using this this trick, I can state that for L small enough, the rational points in this part of the graph of A less than T is in some algebraic curve of degree less than D, where D is given at the very beginning. So I fix D, okay? I fix A. I use this Bombieri-Pilat trick, and if L is not too big, then for sure, the rational points are of A less than T are here. Okay? So, in the minimal case, we have a finite number of such box. Okay. So everything is finite. Everything is uniformly bounded with respect to D, and we are done. But in our situation, we a priori have some interval, and if we do the same trick starting from here, maybe we have another interval, bigger, smaller. We have to look at this, and we have another polynomial of degree less than D. But of course, we a priori we do not know how to bound the number of points in rational curves of degree less than D. So now the fact is, when the derivatives of F are smaller and smaller, for instance, you can imagine something like this. Okay. This is the case for this family of examples. Then the sequence defined by x naught is A, x1 is x naught plus L, L being L0, and so on, xn plus 1 is xn plus ln. So I start over the process from this point, and then from this point, and then from this point. So I define this is x1, this is x2, which is this is x0, this is x2, which is x1 plus L1, and so on. Then this sequence goes to infinity. fast. So the smaller the derivatives of f are, the faster the sequence goes to infinity. And what is good is that we don't have to cover all the line on the right side, because we only care about rational points of h less than t, so we may stop at t, because there is no rational points on the right side of t. So in this situation, for this family, for instance, we could prove that the number of intervals we need to cover minus t is something depending on d, l, and t to some power. Okay? T to some power depending on d. So here we have a power depending on d, which is explicit. So in some sense, this is the substitute of Yomdin-Gromov parametrization in this situation. And now, maybe the hard part of the game is the first step, how to bound the number of points in algebraic curves of degree less than d in the graph of a transcendental function. So here we are very lucky, because in this case we are in a Rovansky theory case, okay? And we have a bound. C'est une horreur ce truc, hein. Jean-Philippe, c'est la dernière fois. Hein. Okay. Okay. Aussi. So we have here an explicit bound. Let me give you the bound. No. So. So now, for the functions FL by Rovansky classical bounds, we know that number of points in the graph of F and in some algebraic curve of degree less than d is less than, okay, 4dl d plus l plus 2 log t over pi. Okay. So if we glue together all these bounds, okay, we have a bound. We have a bound like this. So we have cdl t nu log t bound for okay, but now we have an extra freedom in this situation. The degree d I fix since the beginning. So if you look carefully at the expression of this power depending on d and this constant, you are allowed to fix d as log t. Why not? And if you do this substitution, this guy disappears because the power is some constant. Okay. And finally, we have something like CL log 4L plus 1 of t, okay, for this family. So there is no sensitivity with respect to the parameter L. Yeah. we have the same kind of bond, power of log t. Okay? So we cannot detect the fact that z is definable in the structure by only looking at the parameter and looking at rational points. Okay? So the story are not the same. Okay, but this is only an example. So how to do in the general case? Remember that the second step, the Bombieri-Pilat trick, works perfectly as soon as we have bounds on the derivatives. So for instance, if you take the Riemann zeta function, we have such bound for the derivatives. Of course, the expansion of R with the Riemann zeta function defines a nominal structure. Okay. But in the general statement by Pilat and Wilkie, we do not have a log T, a power of log T bound. We only have a power of T bound. Okay. So if we do the same thing with this guy, everything works till the third step, and for the third step, we can use bound for Messer or bound given by Coman and Poletsky to bound the number of intersection points with between the graph of zeta and an algebraic curve of degree d. And we have a log bound here for this number of points. Okay, so again, gluing together all the bounds for the zeta function, we have something like which is a little bit less. No, it is not better. It is not better than estimate given by Garrett Jones, and I forgot another author. I forgot the name. Or Messer. Messer has a log T bound. Okay. This is a funny name. Box something. Box something like this. Up to some permutation of the letters. Okay. Okay. So these are examples, and what can we do in general? Okay, the second step is okay. Second step is okay. Here, if we have a flat function, the Bombieri-Pilat argument is very good, and this sequence goes fast to infinity, so it's very good. So now, in the general case, how to produce bounds? So now it's a work in progress, and I have to discuss with Yossi, and particular to we have to look at this paper that gives some interesting bounds. And maybe the idea is that when the function is not even transcendental, but transcendental with all its derivatives, it means that there is no algebraic differential equation satisfied by f, then we can say more about this number of points. But this is a work in progress, and I don't want to state something at this point. Okay. So the next step is to find some transcendental condition on the derivatives in order to bound this number. Okay. I stop here.